Come on, work. We dressed up for you and everything. Gee, you got the costume, the beads, and the jewelries, and the rings. And, look at that. Look at that. There's a gypsy in my tree. Hey, Mr. Z, come here. Look at this. This is neat.
Watson, yeah. What's this?
It's my crystal ball.
Oh, my God. Look at Watson here.
Yeah.
In fact, I think we should change his name. Let's call Watson Watserina.
Ooh,
the gypsy.
Yeah.
Look at this. Beads, a gold earring. So what's in the crystal ball? What's in the future for Give Science a Hand today?
Well, it looks to me like there's a gypsy up in the tree.
Oh, I see what this is about. You saw the name of today's program.
Uh-huh.
And you thought it was about real gypsies.
Isn't it?
No, today's program, in fact, is about pests.
Pests?
Yes, not Watson here, even though he sometimes is a little thorn in the
thank
side.
You.
The pests we're talking about are gypsy moths.
Oh.
These are insects that have invaded this country from Europe, and they have no business being here. And we want to give them a one-way ticket back.
Uh-huh.
Problem is, Watson, they don't want to leave. They like it here so much. They've found a lot of places to live and a lot of good things to eat. So to keep their numbers at bay, to reduce their numbers, we've got to come up with a strategy, a plan of action.
Well, what can we do, Mr. Z?
Well, what do you think we could do? What kinds of things could you do to attack insects?
Well, you could set lots of birds loose.
All right, because the birds would be natural enemies, and that's one of the problems. Watson, you're a good student. There aren't enough natural enemies to keep the gypsy moth numbers down where we'd like it.
Gee.
So we could control them.
Uh-huh.
Now, what you could do, of course, is you could spray them with lots of chemicals, right?
Yeah.
Insecticides and pesticides.
Yep.
Well, that's not such a good idea because eventually those pesticides, they'll kill the moths, but they'll get into the soil, get into the water table, maybe get into Chesapeake Bay.
Oh, that's
we're
no
trying
good.
To preserve that.
Uh-huh.
And it could kill fish and other animals later on, and that's too high a price to pay. So on today's program, we're going to suggest to you and to Watson here some methods, some natural ways of controlling pests like the gypsy moth. We're going to take you to the University of Maryland. We're going to introduce you to an entomologist. Big word. He's a bug expert, and he's going to give you some methods that you can use in your own backyard so that you can keep it looking nice and green and healthy and have those gypsy moths go somewhere else.
Okay.
All right?
Yeah.
Now, question for you and for Watson.
Sure.
Now, we know that gypsy moths reproduce very quickly.
Yeah.
They make lots and lots of little baby gypsy moths.
Yeah.
Okay? And you'll find out about the stages they go through in a moment. Well, if you go out into your garden, let's form an analogy here, a little comparison.
Okay.
This is a seed case from a marigold plant.
Yep.
You know those marigolds, Watson.
Yep.
They have that funny odor to them.
Mm-hmm.
If I pull this apart, look at all of these seeds.
Gee, those are all seeds?
These are all seeds. Thousands and thousands of seeds. And if they went and spread all over your lawn and your neighbor's lawns,
uh-huh.
and they all grew, what would happen pretty soon, Watson?
Gee, there'd be no place for anybody to play or do anything.
That's right. We'd be knee-deep in marigolds. There'd be so many, we wouldn't have room, as you say, for anything else.
Yeah.
Now, does that happen?
Gee.
Are there marigolds everywhere? It looks like they have the potential to take over the world.
Well, I guess some of the seeds probably landed in water. And, you know, they don't grow very well out in the street.
That's right. Concrete isn't the best medium for marigolds to grow if they land in the water.
Uh-huh.
Too bad. No marigold there. You said birds could eat them.
Yeah.
Sometimes they get blown onto soil, and the soil's just not good enough for them. So they have a high potential. Remember this, Watson. Here's some technical terms for you. They have a high biotic potential.
Mm-hmm.
They could really take over the world, but it doesn't happen because we keep their numbers down. That's called environmental resistance. So we resist the potential for taking over. Does that make sense?
Sure does.
All right. Same reason why these little... Oh, look at these, Watson.
Oh, look at them. Wow.
Yeah, if you lift up a rock or a timber, you'll find these things crawling underneath. They're relatives of centipedes.
Gee!
I've seen these in my dreams sometimes, Watson, and they're a lot bigger. The same thing happens here. There are so many of them, and they reproduce so quickly that if we didn't check them, if we didn't resist them with things like Watson just mentioned, birds eating them, other things eating them, them dying from natural causes because of infections, we would be knee-deep in these bugs as well. Doesn't sound like too much fun.
No, it sure doesn't, especially when my knees are where your knees are.
So before we go and talk to the entomologist, that bug expert, let's tell you some of the things we don't want you to do. If you go into your basement, if you go outside into your shed, you'll probably find a lot of insecticides like this.
Uh-huh.
Now, insecticides are good because we have an invader that is wily and strong. We've got to fight back. But instead of using dusts and powders and sprays and other kinds of insecticides, let's try the natural route, an alternative.
Okay.
For instance, Watson, in fact, Watserina, if you put some of this behind your ear, it looks like you might want to. This looks like Chanel No. 5. This is a cologne. And what's it supposed to do?
I guess it attracts insects.
Yes, I'd like to see what's attracted to all of this. Anyhow, attractants, colognes, and perfumes, they work on insects as well because they draw them into a trap and that's it. It's all over. They're sent to bug heaven and you haven't used any pesticides.
Hmm.
All right, that's one natural method.
Okay.
And before we go talk to the expert, as I just said, one more thing.
All right.
In other parts of the world, they have pests. Not necessarily insects, but there are lizards in some countries and they climb trees and they eat fruits. Well, in order to keep them from climbing, what's one way you might be able to stop that? Take some tin foil, like this.
Yeah, it's just regular aluminum foil.
You bet. Wrap it around the base of the tree, and if the lizard tries to come up, what's going to happen to it?
It probably slides right back down
again.
Yeah,
it's like trying to go up a greased pole. You just can't get a foothold.
Huh.
So that's one way to keep the lizard alive and save your lunch for yourself.
There you go.
All right?
Yeah.
Let's go find out now how to keep those gypsy moths away from your tree. Stay tuned. Last year, it was the invasion of the cicadas. Now, don't fear because they're not going to be back for another 17 years. But there was another pest last year that you probably overlooked with all the cicada fever, and that was the gypsy moth. We're here at the University of Maryland to tell you and Watson about the gypsy moth, the cankerworm, and the thing that spins those tents up in the trees, the eastern tent caterpillar. So all those things that go squish underfoot, we're going to tell you about today. We're going to bug you a lot. To help us out, we have Mike Rau, who's an entomologist. Big word, he's a bug expert here at the university. He's going to tell us how to recognize these pests, some of the things that you can do to get rid of them, and why they are pests. What do they do? What do they take from us that we want to hold on to? Mike, thanks for joining us today.
It's a pleasure to be here today, Dave. The first insect I'd like to talk about is the first insect we see every year. This is the eastern tent caterpillar. This is a caterpillar that feeds on the leaves of lots of our trees. In particular, they like cherry trees and apple trees quite a bit. So this is really the kind of tree we're going to see these guys on.
So these insects have good taste, Mike.
Apple trees,
cherry trees. Watson identifies with that. He's got a bottomless pit of a stomach there. Tell us, when during the year do these tent caterpillars come? When do they invade?
We're going to see these tent caterpillars very early in the year if we're pretty observant, but we have to get out there in the month of March because that's when they really become active. They begin to build their white silken tents out on the tips of branches. Mm-hmm. Then in the month of April, as the weather warms up, the tent caterpillars move those tents back to the crotches of the branches
mm-hmm.
and build the white silken tents in the crotches, the big crotches of the branches of cherry trees. A lot of people get confused, Dave, and they think that these tent caterpillars are really the gypsy moths. We're going to talk about those guys in a minute. But the tent caterpillars are the ones that build those tents in the crotches of cherry trees and apple trees.
Okay, well, I think we can remember that. The tent caterpillars make those tents, and you've all seen them in the trees. The temptation sometimes is to break that nest open and pull them out. Is that a good way to get rid of them, Mike?
That's actually the best way. If you can reach those tents, go on out there, but you have to go out early in the morning or late at night after dark, because during the daytime, the tent caterpillars are out on the leaves feeding, and at nighttime, they're back in their tents resting. Mm-hmm. So if you go out there early in the morning, you can just pull a tent out and pull the caterpillars out, and you've gotten rid of your problem.
Okay, sounds a little messy, but if you go out during the middle of the day, no one's home. So remember, morning or evening is the time to get rid of them. Mike, you have a couple young ones over here in a bowl. Can we have a look at them?
Sure we can.
Okay, we're going to look at some of these caterpillars. Are these tent caterpillars in here?
Yes, as you can see, these are the little tiny tent caterpillars, and they're easy to recognize because tent caterpillars always have a white stripe down the middle of their back.
Mm-hmm.
They also have some blue dots along the side, which makes them pretty racy looking.
Yeah.
But they're really the only big hairy caterpillar we have that has a white stripe down the back and blue dots along the side.
Okay, so those are key identification marks. If you wonder what that caterpillar is that's crawling across your patio en route to a tree, it's got the white stripe and the blue dots, you've got a tent caterpillar. Now these are young ones. Now you know that bugs, all of you know that study insects, know that bugs, insects go through changes in their life. What's that word, Mike, when they go through changes?
We call that metamorphosis.
Metamorphosis. And there's a complete and an incomplete. What kind are we witnessing here?
Well, all our caterpillars and moths and butterflies go through the type of development we call complete metamorphosis. This is a very interesting kind of development, and what happens here is the female moth or butterfly will lay eggs.
Mm-hmm.
These eggs will hatch into a stage we call the larva.
Right.
The larva goes through several different molts, and between these molts, we call them instars. So they might have a first instar or a second instar, usually 5 or 6 instars, in which time they're caterpillars. Mm-hmm. Now, after they are caterpillar, something very strange and wonderful happens. They change into a stage we call the pupa. Mm-hmm. Now, the pupa is a resting stage. It doesn't feed, it doesn't move too much, but inside the pupa, the caterpillar goes through an amazing transformation in which it changes from something that looks like a worm pretty much into something that's got wings and can fly, what we know as a moth or butterfly. And that's complete metamorphosis, Dave.
Okay, so the key steps are the egg, the larva, the pupa, and then the adult.
That's
right. So what we're looking at here are tiny, are these larvae?
These are first instar larvae. That's correct.
Right. So these guys grow up big and strong after they eat all the leaves in your backyard, which we want to prevent them from doing, and they turn into guys that look like this. Let's dump a few of these out here, of the things we do for Give Science a Hand. All right, now this is a more grown-up tent caterpillar. You can see the hallmarks, the white line, the blue dots, and will this fella get much larger before he forms that that case?
No, Dave, he's almost finished. And the tent caterpillars, when they get to be about this size, they'll wander down from the trees and they'll look for these places to pupate in the soil. Mm-hmm. There, they will form a silken cocoon in the soil and change from this caterpillar into a pupae and then the adult moth.
Okay, I think he's got his eye on my jacket here as a place to pupate, so let's put him back inside the jar. And we have some ideas now about the tent caterpillar, the first one that comes in the season. One way to get rid of them is to reach up and pull them down yourself. Let's talk more about some of these other caterpillars and find out some other ways to get rid of them. What comes next? What's the next invader, Mike?
Well, the next one we usually see each season, Dave, is a kind of caterpillar we call the cankerworm. You may know this, boys and girls, better as an inchworm. And this we find very often on our maple trees. It's quite a bit different than our tent caterpillar because it's not a hairy caterpillar. Mm-hmm. It's naked. And it usually
Well, you can't say this is a children's show here, Mike. What do you mean naked? What doesn't
well,
it have?
Well, it doesn't have the long hairs that the tent caterpillars do.
Okay.
It's fairly hairless. It's a pretty bald caterpillar.
Mike, we've heard about two of the minor league players, I think. Who is the big invader, the one that we really should be concerned about here in Maryland?
Well, Dave, the one we really need to know the most about is one we call the gypsy moth. And as you say, this is an invader. Doesn't really belong here. It came from a different land. Has an interesting story behind it. This was an insect that was brought to this country by a French scientist up outside of Boston in Massachusetts. And he thought he was going to breed the gypsy moth from France with our own silk caterpillars to make a more productive silkworm. Unfortunately, that experiment failed, and even worse, the gypsy moth escaped from his laboratory and began to run rampant in New England. Over the next 100 years, it finally arrived here in Maryland and now has become a pest for us in this state as well.
So you can see, even the big scientists, the ones with good intentions, sometimes have problems with their experiments. So if your science fair experiment didn't work this year, don't feel too bad. It didn't cause the kind of damage that this gypsy moth did. Mike, they're here. Okay, we can't hold them back. We hear about the killer bees advancing on America. We've kept them at bay, but we've got the invader in our midst. What do we do since it's a chronic problem? They're going to be here for a long time. How do we keep their numbers down? What could the students do who are watching? What could they do to get rid of these caterpillars?
That's a very good question. There are a few things to do, and if we remember that these caterpillars have the complete metamorphosis just like the Eastern tent caterpillars did, we can find some places in their life cycle to attack them and help reduce the problem.
Okay, let's do it. We've got egg, larva, pupa, and adult, the 4 stages in the complete metamorphosis. If you've got a gypsy moth caterpillar at the egg stage, what can we do?
Well, if there are eggs out there, you can simply find those eggs, and they're usually on the bases of the trees, under your picnic table tool shed. You can simply scrape those egg masses off of there between August and when they hatch the next April, put them in a paper bag, and get rid of them, and that'll help reduce the problem. One thing that students and everybody should be aware of is some people are allergic to the hairs on those egg masses, so if they're going to scrape those egg masses off, they should wear gloves, not touch them.
Okay, so remember that if you're handling these egg mass cases, protect your hands because you don't want to develop any kind of allergy to those hairs. All right, so if we miss the egg stage, we come to the larval stage. What can we do at that point?
Well, the larvae are there, especially the little ones. They have to walk up into the tops of the trees. So if we put a band up with some sticky material on it, we can prevent those little caterpillars from getting up to the top of the tree and feeding on the leaves. We call this a barrier band. Now, there's another band we can use later on called a burlap band. The caterpillars, when they get large in May and June, come down to hide in the daytime. If you put a burlap band around your tree, they'll come down to hide underneath that band. Once they're under there, you can just squash them, scrape them off, and that helps to control the problem.
Squash them. Okay, this sounds pretty messy, but we've got a tough invader here. We're going
to
do it.
You have to get serious.
Okay, so you've got a sticky band. Lunch is at the top of the tree, but you're trying to prevent them from getting to the restaurant.
Right,
okay?
With a sticky band.
And the burlap bag, they come back down, they hide under that.
During the daytime.
And they only feed at night then.
That's right.
So the daytime, the time we're active, is the best time to get them.
Yes, that's correct.
Now, when they get to the pupa stage, Mike, they're not feeding anymore. And once they emerge, they're going to be adults. Are the adults a threat to us?
Not really. The adults don't feed at all. They're just harmless, fairly harmless insects. The females don't fly.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yep, they've put all their energy, instead of being able to fly, into making eggs. So the female gypsy moth is essentially just a mean egg machine. She doesn't fly, but the male gypsy moth does fly, and they can be seen in the daytime flying around.
So it wouldn't be a bad idea, nothing personal against these adult moths, but if we got rid of them, we could prevent them from reproducing and then cut down on the next season.
That's correct. And sometime you'll even see the gypsy moth pupae and the adult female moths underneath those bands, those burlap bands. And once they're under those bands, they're fair game and can be destroyed under there as well.
So you want to turn yourselves into Terminators. You've all seen that movie or heard about it, but your prey this time is going to be the gypsy moth and the caterpillar and the different stages leading up to it. One last question, Mike. Are there any trees out there that are naturally resistant to these insects?
Fortunately, there are. Many of our local trees here, like our tulip poplar or yellow poplar it's sometimes called, is resistant. It's got nasty chemicals in the leaves, and gypsy moths just can't feed on it. Trees like our holly trees and dogwood trees are also trees that gypsy moths really can't do very well on. And fortunately, there are some other natural things that help control the gypsy moth. They get a virus disease if populations get too big. If there are too many around, they get a virus, and that often causes the population to just collapse.
So Mother Nature sometimes takes care of our problem when we're not as successful.
Yes, she does.
All right, well, that sounds good. So man the battle of the bug brigade, because the gypsy moths are here, and if you're watching this at a time of year when they're not a threat, they're out there waiting. Thanks a lot, Mike, for joining us.
My pleasure.
If your flesh is starting to crawl because you think you've got caterpillars and gypsy moths all over you, that's a natural reaction. Now that we've heard from Mike Raup about how to recognize some of these pests that are invading the forests of Maryland, let's find out exactly what you can do. So Watson, pay attention. Those of you that are out there that are trying to save your forest, I'm going to give you some basic tips on how to keep these trees, like this one in back of me, this giant oak, from defoliating, from losing all of its leaves to the invader. The invader this time being the gypsy moth. Now, like any good scientist, you need some equipment. And in order to do your task properly, here are some of the things you're going to need. Now, if you remember what Mike said, since the hairs on the egg cases and on the adults and some of the larvae can cause irritation, get yourself a good pair of gloves. Rubber gloves, cloth gloves, either kind is fine. You'll need some string. If you have a staple gun, and if you're using older trees, this can come in handy. Since we're going to be measuring things, make sure you have a ruler. Use it if it has inches indicated. Get yourself a pair of scissors, some duct tape, and some special stuff here called tree tanglefoot. Now, this is a sticky resin that we're going to put on the trees to try to trap these gypsy moths. We're going to try to outwit them. We're going to beat them at their own game since we know how they behave. And a very important thing that you'll need to keep these gypsy moths out of this tree is some burlap sacking, as you can see that I have here. You don't need a lot of it. In fact, you need just enough to go around the outside of your tree. Ring around the tree, tie a yellow ribbon, but in this case, you're going to tie a ribbon of burlap sack around the tree that you're going to protect. Now, let's go up and see what we've done and use this as your guide. Pay attention, because some numbers that I give to you are important and some distances. Let's have a look. All right, if this oak tree could talk, it would probably say, thanks, Dave, thanks, Mr. Z, for helping out, because the gypsy moths are going to be foiled. Piece of burlap sack that I ask you to get. Cut enough so it goes around your tree, And at chest height, you may be shorter than I am, but whatever height the chest hits the tree, wrap that burlap sack around. And what I've done is I've taken my staple gun and I've stapled this at about the 6-inch mark. The width of this burlap sack is about a foot, 12 inches. At the halfway point at 6 inches, staple it only if you have an older tree like this one. If you've got a tree with a thin bark, like an aspen, like a willow, don't use the staple gun. Use the string that I showed you earlier. That'll keep the bark from being damaged by what you do. All right, so you've stapled that burlap sack. You put that ring around the tree. Now you want to fold it down like this. All right, it's going to look very neat when you're finished. And you might be asking yourself, well, what's this for? Well, as we just heard, the behavior of the gypsy moth is the way to find out how to defeat it. During the day, it hides. Only at night does it come out to feed. It's no dummy. The birds can't find it at night. So as those caterpillars come down just before dawn, try to find a place to hide, they've just located this and they think, a great place to get in underneath, out of harm's way. Now the birds can't find us. They will crawl underneath the burlap sack. If you lift this up, and we're talking about in the early spring, get this up by early April, if you lift it up, what you're going to find underneath is just what you hope to find. Adults, caterpillars, larvae, pupal stages, the same things Mike Raup was just talking about, all the metamorphic stages. And now comes the squeamish part. You can squish them, pick them off and squeeze them. That's not probably the best way to do it, but you can. Or drop them into some kerosene or a bucket that contains Clorox bleach. Any of those ways will get rid of them and you'll save them from returning the next night to snack on your favorite tree. Now this is one natural way of controlling the gypsy moth and the caterpillar associated with it. Remember, we're trying to stay away from pesticides, insecticides, fungicides, herbicides. Let's kill them the natural way. Now one other thing you might try is to take your duct tape. If you look just below, you've probably seen this. This duct tape I put around the tree at about 6 inches lower than the burlap sack. Now why do you put this duct tape down? As you push it in, make sure that it touches all of the crevices so there's no shortcut, no detour for the caterpillars trying to come up. You want to stop them. You want to put a moat around your tree, but you're not going to dig a hole and fill it with water. You're going to put a sticky barrier, a no man's land, and in this case, a no moth land. Now, after you put the duct tape down, you put this down first so that you don't damage the bark underneath. We're trying to save the tree, not destroy it. You want to get that tangle foot I just talked to you about. Let me reach down and get it here. This is a sticky resin. And if you've ever seen chewing gum that just doesn't want to dry out, that always seems to stay sticky, if you've ever had crazy glue that's always tacky, that's something like what we have here. And if we squeeze this onto our tape, not onto the trunk, never put it onto the trunk directly because it could injure the tree. Squeeze it out, like I'm doing here, and you are effectively putting a barrier around that tree so that the gypsy moth can't get up to its lunch, the leaves up in the top of the canopy here. Now you can use a stick. Try not to get it on your hands because it's difficult to get off. This will keep the caterpillars from going any higher. They get close and they don't cross. Now some things will get stuck here. Other insects, dirt, little bits of leaf, twigs, pick those off occasionally. Try to keep it as dry as you can. And if you don't have any of this tanglefoot, use Vaseline. If you've got a baby brother or sister at home, you know Vaseline is good to keep babies dry. Well, it's also good to deter gypsy moth caterpillars. So this is another way of trying to beat the moth at its own game by knowing its behavior. Keeping these things in mind, you can keep your trees safe. You're going to have all your foliage. If the neighbors lose theirs, that's because they didn't watch Give Science a Hand and listen to some of the advice we gave. We're going to go back, and Watson, we're going to find out how much you remember about these natural ways of controlling the gypsy moth. Stay tuned.
Oh, we're back! Yeah.
Yeah. Now, Watson, what do you remember from today's program? Are we going to turn you into a bug expert?
Sure.
All right. Now, we talked about some pesticides at the beginning of the program, but we talked with the expert, and we went on to the woods to show that there are some natural ways to get rid of those unwanted gypsy moths, right?
Uh-huh. Sure did.
For instance, we learned that holly trees, among other species, are resistant to the gypsy moth.
Yep.
So if you have holly trees in your yard, or if you're thinking about planting trees, a holly would be a good choice because now you've got some natural resistance.
Mm-hmm.
All right, now that's easy. Now, Watson, some questions for you.
Okay.
And if you want to look in your crystal ball to find the answers, that's quite
yep,
all right.
Yep, got it right here.
Okay. We talked about some creatures that could reproduce in large numbers, like gypsy moths and eastern tent caterpillars. We said that they had a high biotic what?
Crystal ball, don't fail me now.
Biotic.
I see potential.
Potential, all uh-huh. right. You may not have a crystal ball. I know you remembered it. Watson sometimes needs a crutch here. Now, to keep creatures like the gypsy moth from taking over,
uh-huh.
even though they seem to be, we need things to keep their numbers down. Like the burlap sack we put around the tree.
Yeah.
Like the tacky foot, the tangle foot we wrapped around on that duct tape.
Yep.
Those are examples, natural methods, of environmental what, Watson?
Oh, crystal ball! I see resistance!
All right, he's got two of them. Environmental yeah. resistance opposes biotic potential.
Uh-huh.
Let's give him one last question here.
All right.
We looked at these insects and they went through different stages in their life.
Uh-huh.
Now we know that the adult gypsy moths aren't as much a problem as the other three steps, the egg, the larva, the pupa, and finally the adult, which
yeah.
we said is not such a problem.
Okay.
What do we call that change? Let's see if Watson remembers. There are two kinds, complete and incomplete. Complete and incomplete what, Watson? Metamorphosis. All right, the crystal
yeah.
ball came through with some of it. It was a little foggy in there.
Oh, it's real fuzzy in here, yeah.
He couldn't get the full word. Today's program, we hope, gave you some ideas about how to take care of your garden and how to control pests in a way that doesn't threaten the rest of the environment. Watson, the last word on today's program is yours. Why don't you look into the crystal ball and see what's in the future for the students? Is there something in there you can see?
Crystal ball, crystal ball, show me. Oh, we want to keep everything environmentally safe and use natural methods to control pests.
All right, that sounds pretty good. Good advice from the gypsy here.
Thank you.
Thanks for joining us today on Give Science a Hand. Remember, use the natural methods to control the pests. See you next time. Bye-bye.
Mr. Z, I've been kidnapped by a band of gypsy moths! Ah!